हेलो एवरीवन, वेलकम टू आईटीएलएस एकेडमी। आवर टुडेज लेक्चर इज स्टेराइल फार्मास्यूटिकल प्रोडक्ट्स। वी विल सी अबाउट स्टेराइल फार्मास्यूटिकल प्रोडक्ट्स। दिस इज पार्ट वन। एज दिस लेक्चर दिस टॉपिक इज वेरी लॉन्ग सो कैन नॉट कंप्लीटेड इन वन लेक्चर। दैट्स व्हाई दिस इज पार्ट फर्स्ट। इन नेक्स्ट सेक्शन we will discuss our left out things. So let's start with the sterile pharmaceutical products. First of all, we will see what are sterile products. Here is definition of sterile products. First point, sterile products are the doses form of therapeutic agents that are free from viable microorganisms. Next point, these sterile products include the following. First one, parenterals. Second one, ophthalmic. And third one is irrigating preparations. These are the formulations of the sterile products. Next point in sterile products is, of these parenteral products are unique among the dosage form of the drugs because they are injected through skin or mucous membrane. This is the property, and by skin and mucous membrane they are injected into the internal body compartments. So let us see sterile pharmaceutical products introduction. Very first point is, certain forms of drug administration and other pharmaceutical products such as dressings and sutures must be sterile in order to avoid the possibility of nosocomial, that is hospital induced nosocomial infections arising from their uses. Next point, while inoculation of human pathogenic bacteria, fungi or viruses poses the most obvious danger to the patient, it should also be realized that microorganisms usually regarded as non-pathogenic, which inadvertently gain access to body activities in sufficiently large numbers, can also result in a severe, often fatal infection. Consequently, injections of ophthalmic preparations, irrigation fluids, dialysis solutions, sutures and ligatures, implants, certain surgical dressings as well as instruments necessary for their use or administration must be presented for use in a sterile condition. Next point, the choice of methods employed to sterile pharmaceutical products is determined largely by the ability of the formulation and container to withstand the physical stresses applied by moist heat treatment. The primary considerations relate to the ability of active ingredients to withstand the applied stress and of the container to maintain the product in a sterile condition until use. Next point, the test method provides a qualitative method for identifying and detecting the characteristics of such particles together with an indication of their possible origin. And the limits are given in the United States Pharmacopoeia, and these were given in 1995. And these limits are for large volume injections. So in the pharmaceutical products, that is sterile pharmaceutical products, first of all we will see injections. These are sterile products. First is a design philosophy. You can see these are designs for the injection preparations. These are sterile products are given. This needle of the injection is sterile. All over the injection that is packed in a packing is sterile. The formulation of the injection is also in sterile condition. So the very first point in design philosophy is any injectable product must be designed and produced to the highest possible pharmaceutical standards. The formulation must be such as to ensure that the product remains physically and chemically stable over the designated shelf life. Next point, the packaging must prevent water, excipient or a drug loss during sterilization and storage, and in addition retain microbiological integrity. Here the packaging must not contribute any significant amounts of extractable chemicals to the contents. For example, vulcanizing agents from rubber or plasticizers from polyvinyl chloride, that is PVC, infusion containers. Next point is the formulation of injections depends upon several factors, namely the aqueous solubility of the active ingredients, the dose to be employed, thermal stability of the solution, and the route of injection, and in the last, whether the product is to be prepared as a multi-dose one or in a single dose form. Some types of injections must be made isoosmotic with blood stream. This applies particularly to large volume intravenous infusions. If at all possible, hypotonic solutions cause lysis of red blood corpuscles and thus must not be used for this purpose. And the fourth point is, intraspinal injections must also be isotonic, and to reduce pain at the site of injection, so should intramuscular and subcutaneous injections. Next comes intravenous infusions. These are also sterile pharmaceutical products. So the first point, these intravenous infusions consist of large volume injections or drips, that is 500 ml or more, that are infused at various rates, for example 50 to 500 ml per hour, into the venous system. They are sterilized in an autoclave. These are used to maintain fluid and electrolyte balance, for replacement of extracellular body fluids, for example after surgery or during prolonged periods of fluid loss, as a supplementary energy source, that is 1 liter of 5% weight by volume glucose is equal to 714, that is 714 kilojoule of energy. And also work as a vehicle for the drugs. Next point, a small range of intravenous infusions, for example those containing amino acids or chloromethiazole, are prepared in glass containers. Although bottles are sterilized by autoclaving, it is still possible for the infusion in glass bottles to become contaminated with microorganisms before use. Next point, most infusions are now packed in plastic containers. The plastic material should be pliable, thermoresistant, transparent, and non-toxic. Plasticized PVC and polyethylene are commonly used. The former, that is PVC, is transparent and very pliable, allowing the pack to collapse as the contents are withdrawn. Fourth point, an important advantage of all plastic packs is that the containers are hermetically sealed prior to autoclaving, and therefore spray cooling water cannot enter the pack unless there is a seal failure, an easy detected occurrence. However, the autoclaving of plastic bags is more complex than that of bottled fluids because a steam and air mixture is necessary to prevent bursting of the bags while heating, that is, prevent air blasting. Adequate mixing of the steam and air is therefore required to prevent layering of gases inside the chamber. Next is intravenous additives. Intravenous additives are another pharmaceutical, that is, sterile pharmaceutical products. So the very first point in intravenous additives is a common practice in hospitals is to add drugs to infusions immediately prior to or during administration. The most common additives are potassium chloride, lignocaine, heparin, certain vitamins and antibiotics. The drug may degrade rapidly, for example, amphicillin in 5% weight by volume glucose. Multiple additions may lead to precipitation of one or both of the drugs or to accelerate degradation. Next point is, any addition should be made in a laminar flow workstation or isolator, preferably in the pharmacy, and the fluid administered within 24 hours. Unless prepared under strict aseptic conditions. Next point, another approach to the problem of providing an intravenous drug additive service is to add the drug to a small volume, that is 50 to 100 ml infusion in a collapsible plastic container and store the preparation at minus 20 degrees centigrade in a freezer. Many antibiotics are stable for several months when stored in mini bags at minus 20 degrees centigrade. and these are unaffected by the thawing process in a suitable microwave oven. Other antibiotics, for example ampicillins, are degraded when frozen. Total parenteral nutrition, in short TPN. First point, total parenteral nutrition is the use of concentrated mixture of amino acids, vitamins, inorganic salts and an energy source, that is carbohydrate or fat emulsions. For example, soybean oil with lecithin as emulsifying agent for the long-term feeding of patients who are unconscious or unable to take food. Bactericides may not be used in injections in which the total volume to be injected at one time exceeds 15 ml. This may occur if the solubility of our drug is such that a therapeutic dose is only soluble in the order of volume. Next point, transfer of amino acid, glucose and electrolyte infusions and the addition of vitamins and trace elements must be carried out with great care under aseptic conditions to avoid microbial contamination. Total perinatal nutrition contents are infused over a 12 to 24 hour period. Small volume aqueous injections. First point, this category comprises single dose injections, usually of 1 to 2 ml but as high as 50 ml, dispensed in borosilicate glass ampoules, plastic, that is polyethylene or polypropylene ampoules, or rarely multi-dose glass vials of 5 to 15 ml capacity, stoppered with a rubber closure through which a hypodermic needle can be inserted, and for example insulins and vaccines. Next point, bactericides must be added to injections in multi-dose containers to prevent contamination during withdrawal of successive doses. Here comes non-injectable sterile fluids. First one is non-injectable water. This is a sterile water. Not necessarily if injectable water standards, which is used widely during surgical procedures. For wound irrigation, moistening of tissues, washing of surgeon's gloves and instruments during use, and when bound as a hemostat. Second point, urological or bladder irrigation solution. These are used for the rinsing of the urinary tract to add tissue integrity and cleanliness during or after surgery. Either water or a glycine solution is used. The latter eliminating the risk of intravascular hemolysis when electrosurgical instruments are used. Third point, inhaler solutions. In cases of severe acute asthmatic attacks, these are asthmatic attacks, bronchodilators and steroids for direct delivery to the lungs may be needed in large doses. The drug is diluted in small volumes of water for injections before loading into the reservoir of the machine. Fourth type of non-injectable sterile fluids is peritoneal dialysis and hemodialysis solutions. Peritoneal dialysis solutions are admitted into the peritoneal cavity as a means of removing accumulated waste or toxic products following renal failure or poisoning. If we talk about the hemodialysis, so the hemodialysis is the process of circulating the patient's blood through a machine via tubing composed of a semi-permeable material, such that the waste products permeate into the dialyzing fluid and the blood then returns to the patient. Hemodialysis solutions need not be sterile but must be free from heavy bacterial contamination. So here our session of today ends. Thank you for watching. Follow ITLS Academy on Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, WhatsApp and LinkedIn. For latest videos and updates, subscribe ITLS Academy on YouTube and also get it on Google Play Store. Thank you for watching. If you like this video, then like it, share with your friends. And also subscribe the channel ITLS Academy. For any help or query, you can call us our helpline number 7080833450 or you can reach us on our website www.itlsacademy.com. Thank you very much again for watching this session.